Hello, I'm Michael Glick, editor of the Journal of the American Dental Association. With me here today, I've got Dr. Zero from Indiana University, who's going to talk about an upcoming article in the April issue of JADA. Dr. Zero, welcome.
Thank you very much. And I want to thank you and the Journal of the American Dental Association for this opportunity to represent my co-authors on the article, as well as to thank the Sjögren Syndrome Foundation for supporting this guidelines development process.
So this article is about the clinical practice guidelines for oral management of patients with Sjögren disease. And I have asked Dr. Zero to come here today to elaborate and give us some more insights about the disease as well as the management of these patients. So let's start with, Sjögren is an autoimmune connective tissue disorder. Are there any other disorders we should be concerned about?
Yes, there are a number of other disorders that are of a similar disease pattern. And they would include lupus, scleroderma, and probably the number one disease, which would be rheumatoid arthritis. These connective tissue diseases involve an immune response directed specifically at connective tissue, which are structural components that hold the cells together.
So obviously, you being a cardiologist, you are concerned about reduced salivary flow and the risk of developing caries in patients with Sjögren's disease. So the other connective tissue disorders, do they present with the same type of side effects?
Well, first of all, Sjögren's has the most severe effect on the salivary glands and results in the most severe reduction in salivary flow in patients. But these other disorders I mentioned, the other autoimmune diseases I mentioned earlier, they also can decrease salivary flow, but generally to a lesser extent.
In the article, you mentioned specifically that dentists should be part of the coordinating team of treating these patients. Specifically, where do you see the dentist fit in coordination as well as how the dentist can benefit the patient?
First of all, I think the dentist can be involved in the initial diagnosis stage. Sometimes these conditions are not diagnosed to late stage in the disease, and when the patient has already suffered a lot of damage to the teeth. So if we can identify patients, and typically this occurs in middle-aged women, it occurs at a much higher frequency in women than men. So in that age group, we can focus in a little bit. And if we see some of the clinical signs of decreased salivary flow, and these include increased caries, problems with obviously the presentation of dry mouth, lack of pooling of saliva in the floor of the mouth, enlarged parotid glands, the chipping and breaking of teeth associated with erosive tooth wear, difficulty eating food and swallowing, difficulty speaking. These are many things that a dentist can ask questions about and drill down a little bit and identify this patient as potentially a Sjögren's patient if they have decreased salivary flow. I think there's a tendency in dentistry, I see this also in the clinic at our dental school, when students see patients with decreased salivary flow associated with numerous medications that have that side effect, they immediately make that association without really doing a differential diagnosis. I think Sjögren's in any patient that presents with decreased salivary should be part of the differential diagnosis.
So what other systemic signs and symptoms would you look for specifically in the Sjögren patient in that case?
Well, Sjögren's patients, first of all, it is a systemic disease. It's a chronic and progressive systemic disease. So these patients can present with fatigue, muscle and joint pain, GI motility problems, and also peripheral neuropathies. So if patients have these complaints or these symptoms, this could also be an indication they're a Sjögren's patient.
Anything about the eyes as well?
Well, again, I think one of the most important questions to ask once you associate the patient having some decreased salivary flow is to ask the question, do they have dry eyes? But there is a need to drill down a little bit. Some patients, again, as I mentioned earlier, may not realize they have this problem. And if they have pain in their eyes, if they have burning in their eyes, if they have a sensitivity to light, if they have frequent eye infections, this could be an indication that they have Sjögren's.
So the practice guidelines specifically deals with caries prevention. Could you elaborate a little bit more on it? Exactly what are the recommendations? What should we do?
Yes, I can. And first of all, if we just go from the article, there was really a general recommendation, a strong recommendation for the use of fluoride. However, if I use my understanding of the evidence in relationship to fluoride, and some of that comes actually from evidence-based reviews that were supported by the Center for Evidence-Based Dentistry on professionally applied fluorides, if we combine that evidence for high-risk patients and apply it to a Sjögren's patient who must be considered a high-risk patient, these patients would benefit, in my mind, from, first of all, frequent recall, at least every 3 months. They would benefit from topical fluoride applications every 3 months, which could be either with using fluoride varnish or an APF, a 1.23% fluoride APF treatment gel. So that would be maybe the first thing that the dentist should be doing on a regular basis with these patients. But also, we know that the concentration of fluoride toothpaste also matters. And so high concentration toothpaste, prescription strength toothpaste, are also indicated in these patients. And I would recommend that they brush at least twice a day, and possibly three times a day. And that most importantly, that they would brush before they went to bed, because that's the most important time to apply fluoride.
Staying with fluoride for a moment, you write in the article, the evidence for fluoride use is weak because investigators in only one study of the 13 look specifically at patients with Sjögren's disease. Yet in the table with clinical questions recommendations for caries prevention, you rate the recommendation as strong.
Correct.
Could you elaborate on that?
Yes, I can. There are many systems to evaluate evidence and make recommendations. And at the start of this process, this was an extensive review of these different systems. And it was decided by the Sjögren's Foundation in developing these clinical practice guidelines that they would adopt a system developed by the American Society of Clinical Oncology, ASCO. And so in that system of developing guidelines, it leaves a little bit more room for including expert opinion into rating the strength of the evidence. So where other systems might be a little more strict on this. So this in this process, we included clinicians, both academic as well as community clinicians. We included hygienists, we included patients, we included a vast catchment of people who had some interest in this area, who were stakeholders. And based on their input, we actually increased the strength of the recommendation from moderate to strong because of those recommendations. And we went through the process. It's a modified Delphi process. And in doing so, we raised the recommendation to a strong category, a strong rating.
You mentioned fluoride. Is there any way we can increase the salivary function in these patients?
Yes, along with fluoride, I think probably the next major arm, this was covered in the article as well, even though, again, the evidence was rated as weak because he had no evidence, basically, that it can prevent caries. But there's pharmacological approaches. The typical approaches involve pilocarpine hydrochloride, as well as sevelamine hydrochloride, which is another class of drugs which can be used to increase salivary flow. Increasing salivary flow in patients that still have residual gland capacity, of course, because the disease can progress to the point where they don't, can be very helpful, not only in helping prevent possibly dental caries, but also improving the patient's quality of life, which is a very important issue in these patients. And in addition to that, recommending sugar-free candies, lozenges, that sort of thing to stimulate salivary flow, and also chewing sugar-free gum is indicated in these patients, in the patients that can chew gum.
So saliva also protects us from developing candida infection. My assumption is that these patients may develop some candidiasis.
Yes, there's a much higher incidence of candidiasis in this patient population, as well as patients with decreased salivary flow in general. And in those patients who are developing a candida infection, they should be prescribed topical antifungal agents, and in the patients where this is not working well, you can also go on with systemic antifungals.
So refractory cases, we can go to systemic antifungal medications.
Correct.
Wonderful. This Sjögren disease is almost like a prototype for the autoimmune connective tissue disorders. The same protocols or the same clinic practice guidelines that you recommend in the article, could we apply it to other patients as well with hyposalivation?
Absolutely. So a lot of the information that we obtained to support the recommendations for Sjögren patients actually came from studies done on patients which had decreased salivary flow as a side effect of medications, as well as patients that had head neck radiation, as well as other diseases. So in any patient that has decreased salivary flow, which would be considered high risk for the hard tissue, the tooth complications, the increased caries, increased dental erosion, as well as the mucosal complications like candidiasis, as well as ulceration, these patients would benefit from this protocol. That's what we're recommending here.
Now, when you talk about caries, my assumption is that you are specifically talking about cervical caries.
Well, typically in adults with decreased salivary flow, we see this pattern of cervical caries, which can be very destructive to the teeth, can even lead to breaking of teeth and undermining of teeth. So the pattern is typically cervical caries or caries around the necks of the teeth. One other thing, if I can go back, would be is not to lose sight that of the role that oral hygiene can play, and also of dietary modifications. So in these patients, they really need fastidious oral hygiene, and so reinforcing oral hygiene every 3 months in these patients is very important in improving their techniques, and also modifying their diet. Sugar is a main driver of caries in all patients. But in a salivary dysfunction population, a patient with decreased salivary flow, diet is really a main driver. And so sugar needs to be really severely restricted, especially between meals in these patients. And using sugar substitutes like xylitol and sorbitol is also a good line of action.
Wonderful. Dr. Zira, I want to thank you very much for coming here and sharing your insight and expertise with our readers. Thank you very much.
It was really my pleasure. Thank you.
JADA is available in print, online, and with the JADA app.